Slide on the pimp gang with my pinky ring. Lot of gang, lot of bitches in the icy chain. While you claim that you rich, that's a false claim. I be straight to the whip, no back.
For the second consecutive season, the Packers and Lions met in the playoffs in 1994, this time at Lambeau Field. What is arguably one of the Packers' greatest defensive performances of all time, the Packers held Lions running back Barry Sanders to -1 yard rushing, and the Lions to -4 yards rushing overall. The Packers never trailed, ultimately won the game 16-12. Memorable Moments, brought to you by the Oneida Casino.
This one carrying into the end zone, about 4 yards deep. Here comes Dixon to the 5. Left hash marks, 10, 15. Hits the hole.
I know I just had one person to beat, and once I pass the kicker, it's party time.
Breaks into the clear. Keyshawn Nixon is off to the races. It is a touchdown. My goodness.
Word on the street is they had the best returner, so hopefully we settled that today.
That brought a lot of energy, obviously, into the stadium and into our team. And Sab with the pick six, that was awesome. I mean, scoring in every phase of the game. It doesn't get much better than that.
He's got an escort to the 20, 15, 10, 5. Touchdown, Green Bay Packers.
I want to say over the last four games, we've had 12 takeaways. And if you do that, you got a good chance of winning the game.
The Packers earned a fourth straight win Sunday after registering four takeaways for the second straight game. Green Bay scored four of its five touchdowns off Minnesota turnovers, powering the Pack to a season-high 41 points. And thanks to a Commander's loss, the Packers' mission is suddenly simple. Win this Sunday and punch a ticket to the playoffs.
Jones around the left end. He's into the clear to the 40.
I'm proud of everybody in this locker room. Resiliency, you know, we blocked out the outside noise when everybody wrote us off. Everybody, literally everybody except for these guys in this locker room, the people upstairs. So proving people wrong, that's one of the best feelings.
You know, we've all seen some of the commentary outside as we went from 4-8 to 5-8 to 6-8, and nobody's worried about the Packers and blah, 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 blah. Now what are you going to say?
To the end zone, Rodgers for the touchdown.
There were a lot of different things that could happen, and we stuck together, and we put ourselves in position to do something special.
That you never even imagined seeing, because you've had injuries, and you know what the score is like.
Yeah.
That was just a different level that you never really
Yeah, for sure. Yeah, I mean, you know, I've punctured my lung. I've been taking an ambulance to the hospital. I've, you know, had many injuries over my career, but to see someone, see a player, one of my brothers, one of my fraternity brothers here in the NFL go through something like that, that's very difficult to watch. You know, I can't even express the emotions. It's been a roller coaster. I've had tears. I've been mad, I've been angry, I've been asking why, how, you know, it's real. Like, we're real people. I know that, you know, we put a helmet on and we take the field and we're like present day gladiators, and but we go home to a family. I got two kids at home that's expecting me to walk back in that door. So I got a wife, I got a dad that's here. My mom's coming up this weekend. You know, I have family and I have people that care about me, and as all of us, all of our players, all my teammates, all my NFL brothers, we all have this feeling. You know, we all understand what we do to put our bodies on the line to go out there and play this game. But it is a game at the end of the day, and you don't expect that you're gonna see or have someone go through what he's going through right now. And I really just hope that, and I think that everyone has really felt the gravity of the situation, and we'll see where we go from here.
Randall, when you think about him and his family, at what point then do you think about Ida and Cade and Caspian and the risks that you take yourself and the family that you care about, and them worrying about you and the dangers that you undertake playing this game? How does that part kind of go around in your mind right now?
Well, I mean, I can't sit here and deny that those thoughts go through my head, and that's one of the reasons that I'm up at night these past couple of nights. You know, me and my wife have conversations about it. You know, you don't expect you don't expect to see anything like that. You know, obviously, I've seen many injuries. I've seen guys be carted off the field, put in neck braces, and, you know, you're always sitting there waiting for the thumbs up, like, oh, he's going to be okay, like, he's going to come through this. But this is a violent game that we play, and it's tough. You know, I really can't put into words the emotions that I've been feeling personally the past few days.
Would you prefer these games be pushed back a week because of all the emotions everybody's going through right now, or?
How much time is enough time? You know, I really don't know. I don't know if anyone knows. You know, I don't know what the league plans to do or how they plan on going about it. You know, I don't know. I can't make that call. I can't make that decision. I think they made the right decision. With the coaches, at least. I don't know, you know, how everything else played out during that situation, but I have so much respect for those two coaches making the decision to send their players to the locker room.
I apologize for the segue, but just regarding football itself, just with the importance of this game, the way y'all turned this season around, how does this not remind you of 2016, the surge y'all had late last season?
It definitely has some similarities. You know, the course of the season, the way that it went, you know, and for us to battle back and be in this situation and have an opportunity, that's all you can ask for. You know, when you play this game, is you hope to have an opportunity to play in the playoffs and make some magic happen.
You guys feel like you're going around the table at this point?
We say every single week, like we've talked about recently here the past few weeks, it's all about winning one game. We feel like we've been in the playoff for the past two or three weeks now, and we found a way to win football games in different ways. And it's not about running the table at this point. We got to find a way to get into the playoffs. We're still not there. So,
is there something to the fact that you guys have made the playoffs in a lot of different ways, early and, you know, clinched early or whatever, and now having to fight for it to the very last game? Is there value in that, or playing well going in?
Well, every team has every year there's a different team that has a different situation and adversity they have to face. You got to think there's not a whole lot of games that's been a whole lot of players on this team that went through those runs that, you know, a few of us, me, Aaron, and Mason, and a few other guys that have been through those runs. So you know, we got a lot of young players on this team, and we try to get them to understand just the magnitude of this opportunity. But you know, yeah, it's a new year.
Cousins looks, loft, left side.
Intercepted. Down the right sidelines, Adrian Amos.
We're going to have a good story to tell. You know what I'm saying? But we got to finish it. Now it's 0-0. We've been in playoff mode for a while, and we got to continue it going this week.
I mean, it's playoff football. That's it. It's playoff football from here on out, and it's been that way for weeks, and it shouldn't change.
Jair Alexander in coverage, and the Packers defense gets the stop.
On Sunday night, Green Bay's secondary has another tall task in Detroit's top five ranked offense, led by quarterback Jared Goff. The former first overall pick tops the NFC in touchdown passes and 20-plus yard throws, helping the once 1-6 Lions roar back into the playoff picture, posting 30-plus points in an NFL-best 8 games this season. His top target? Amon-Ra St. Brown, who has a team-leading 6 scores, 100 grabs, and more than 1,100 yards through the air.
He is a tough competitor. He is a dog. His ability to win his one-on-ones, to make tough catches, to get yak, he's a scrappy dude. He's got a great rapport with Jared, and they've made a lot of plays together.
But Green Bay's back end is capitalizing on any and everything of late, reeling in 6 picks over its last 5 quarters.
Intercepted by Rasul Douglas, and there is your dagger!
Guys are playing off one another. We're playing a lot better. I think we're playing with a lot more passion. I think it's evident. It shows up all over the tape. Guys are excited. You can see it all last night from the first play throughout the course of the game.
He just believed on me. Don't be scared to make a play tonight. Talk about me, 1-2-3.
Justin Jefferson, leading receiver in the NFL. One catch for 15 yards versus the Packers and Jair Alexander. second play of the game, Ja sets the tone and lets Jefferson know his day is not going to be fun. Be it a run or a pass elsewhere, Ja would be making his life difficult.
Well, I get into a mode and it's just like, all right, you know, it is what it is. You just going to have to deal with it.
Ja also got physical with his coverage and save a tip at the line of scrimmage. That's a likely interception.
Anytime you got the best on the best, like, shoot, who wouldn't want to wake up to that, you know? Like, I thought about that all week.
But Ja refused to get predictable. He'd fake the physical and then drop into hip-to-hip and step-to-step coverage. And that's what really determined the winner in this battle of the best, Ja's ability to cover man-to-man. It was more than tight. It was suffocating. And that one catch for 15 yards, it did not come against Ja.
Today, man, it feels spectacular. It feels phenomenal. It feels supercalifragilisticexpialidocious.
Jay Slayton made his very first start against the Vikings, and he made the most of it. PJ, taking on the double team, defeating said double team, leaving a blocker in his wake, and then look at this. TJ with a picture-perfect form tackle, dip and lift on the very dangerous Dalvin Cook. TJ playing a big part in holding Cook to 27 yards rushing and just 3 yards a carry. Big goal line stand after the block punt, TJ playing his gap, Cook goes the other way, and TJ says, not so fast. And that allows time for reinforcements to arrive. And on third and goal from the one, Cook loses one. Pass rush now. And TJ is 6'4", 330 pounds. And if he wants to get somewhere, there are not a whole lot of folks who can stop him. Certainly not the Viking center. TJ all over Kirk Cousins. He deflects the pass. Adrian Amos intercepts. And look at the big man. He's up here looking for work. He finds it. And the Packers were in the end zone 5 plays later. TJ actually deflected 2 passes. And on this play, he doesn't get the ball, but he affects the quarterback nonetheless. He adds a wrinkle to his power rush, a right arm rip, and that puts him right back in Cousins' face, and almost predictably, it's a lousy pass and another interception. TJ Slayton making a very first career start that he can build on.
It works well for my confidence because at the end of the day, like, I'm only a second-year guy, and, you know, everybody else is on the looking at, like, what is this second-year guy going to do, you know, to stick around. So, you know, it boosts my confidence because it's like not only I can, you know, play with our ones, I can also, like, play against other people's ones, and it gives me the confidence that I can actually, you know, play this game at a high level. So it's pretty good.
Congratulations to kickoff returner extraordinaire and new special teams player of the week, Keyshawn Nixon.
Oh, here he goes! My goodness! He's taking it the distance!
Nixon now ranks number one in franchise history in single-season kickoff return average, and he leads the league in kick returns of 50-plus yards, ripping off 5 over his last 5 games. But the Lions have a touchdown maker of their own in former Packer Jamal Williams, who leads the NFL in rushing touchdowns. Detroit's top back is coming off a career-best 144 yards on the ground. He's equal parts bruising and explosive, with the ability to out-muscle would-be tacklers or rip it around the edge for a home run.
He is a tough, gritty competitor. He's a guy that I think is severely underrated back in this league in terms of the versatility he brings, because we know he can run the ball, he can pass pro as good as anybody, he can catch the ball out of the backfield, so I hold him in high regard.
But the Packers have their own all-purpose back in Aaron Jones, who lit up the Lions for 4 TDs in the last Lambeau meeting between these rivals.
Showtime to the pylon! Touchdown, Green Bay!
And come Sunday night, with temps in the 20s, number 33 will be in his element.
The weather gets a little bit colder. We just get a little bit more physical, and it's just a mentality that we have, and we know that through the run game, we can provide a spark. Whether it's a big player just running somebody over, we could get the sideline amped up and get guys going. So just continue to look to be that spark and, you know, bring everybody together.
Like Rich coaches me up a lot, but he kind of let me just be me and just do what I do. He don't really coach me too much on it, you know what I'm saying? If it's something he was like, you should have just read it or slow down a little bit, then hit it, you know what I'm saying? He give me feedback on it, but he kind of let me just do what I want to do.
The important thing is the blocking.
They're great. You know, these guys been, excuse me, they've been blocking their ass off for me, you know? these guys been great.
So I know guys have been making fun of you, saying you couldn't beat the kicker or make a miss. And then we seen Miami, you made the kicker miss.
Right.
And then guys after that were still making fun of you, saying you can't score. Go all the way.
Right.
And now you have done that. So what do you have to say to the guys who said these type of things about you?
You were those guys.
Yeah.
So I really appreciate you because you turned me up. You know what I'm saying? It's more confidence boost. Now it went from, can you score one touchdown? Now these guys are greedy. They want another one. So we just got to see what happens on Sunday.
Okay. Another question. You're back there and the ball's getting kicked off.
Yeah.
What is going to be your motto?
Score. Take it out every time. Ain't scared of nothing.
So does it matter where the ball lands? If it's 109 or?
We're taking it out.
Okay, if the ball is going through the uprights, would you even jump to get it to try to score?
If it's short and I can jump, I'm going to grab it.
Okay.
So why didn't you just start the third quarter?
It wasn't my call. Yeah.
Who told you to? Because I think LaFleur said he was surprised you didn't take it out.
Yeah. Sometimes it's higher up, you know?
What was the Lambeau leap like?
Oh, I loved it.
Yeah?
Yeah, it was like a adrenaline rush you never felt before. I want to feel it again, so you know what that means.
Did you get a beer spill on you?
Nah, nobody hit me with no beer. I'm really a beer guy. I don't even like beer like that. Yeah.
First off, just talk about how this team is one win, right? One win away from the playoffs. Talk about what that means to you, like that mindset about that.
Yeah. Honestly, not what it means to me, but kind of what it means to the team is it's kind of been our mindset the last handful of weeks, just, you know, either, you know, you win or you go home. And I think that that has kind of just shown the competitive nature of this team and this group. And, I think it's just brought out the best in us.
And then pretty much you guys are going to have a playoff atmosphere, right?
Yeah.
Home at Lambeau, NFC North opponent, winner gets in. You couldn't ask for anything better than that, right?
Right. Like I said, I just think the win and go home, everything is all up in the air. You know, the do or die, quote unquote. I think like that is going to show what type of, you know, men are in this locker room, and I think that we're looking pretty good in terms of just like kind of everyone's mindset for that and everyone's focus. So I'm happy with where we're at.
And you spoke about that mindset. It really kind of boils down right to just everyone, you know, doing their job, making those plays, that one play that limit those explosive plays, make those explosive plays. Just talk about what that team mindset is with that.
Yeah, I mean, you don't know what play is gonna, you know, be the determining factor of the game. So I think just, you know, taking every play, you know, play by play, and just like how you take things day by day, and just just when your number is called, make the play, and just keep grinding.
Anything else?
When you are in the position you're in a month ago, and you find your way to this position, how does that feel?
Good. I mean, I don't think anyone in here in this room, you know, in this locker room, counted, you know, ourselves out. So I don't think that there's a, you know, this big, you know, breakthrough or epiphany that went on. I think that we just kind of got hot and came together at the right time.
Obviously, now that you control your destiny, you did last Sunday as well once the early results came in. But once that happens, does it increase the pressure on yourselves? Because at the start of this run, it's like nothing to lose. Let's go out there and win. But does the pressure ratchet up when you know that you actually control things?
I think that just makes us more at ease knowing what is at stake rather than just a bunch of, you know, possibilities going on. And this person's got to lose and this person's got to win. But like I said before, I think that everyone in this room was confident with these last handful of weeks going through. So,
Aaron had said they came back from the bye as a team. He could tell that this team was somehow just playing more loose, practicing more loose. Is that something you noticed as well? And how would you describe that shift? And do you have any idea what led to it?
Yeah, I would agree. I think we just needed a break. I think it was a long time, you know, from the London trip on. Obviously, that was kind of where we were struggling at. But, yeah, I think we just needed a bye week pretty bad.
You guys have played a number of playoff games during your time here. Does this have that type of feel? Even though it's regular season, does it feel in here like a playoff week?
Absolutely. I think, honestly, every home game in Lambeau has that playoff atmosphere. I mean, the best fan base in the NFL, and then, you know, Lambeau gets jumping pretty easily. So, you know, a couple good plays or, you know, a couple defensive stops, and that place is rocking. So I think, yeah, Lambeau is definitely a playoff atmosphere at all times.
What have you seen from their defense? They played well against you guys first game. Overall, they're not very good. What have you seen from that group?
I mean, they play hard. They're talented. They got young guys flying all over the place. I mean, they are talented. I mean, you know, people wouldn't have thought our offense was really that good, you know, earlier on in the season. So you can't really kind of make that, you know, opinion on them. But I think they get paid to do what they do too. So I think they have good players and they got a good coach. So it's going to be a good game.
Okay, so what's clicked on your side of the ball? I think the last four games you were third in scoring or fourth in scoring. Maybe you've been third without taking any at the one. What's worked for you guys?
I think just more playing more free and just going out there and executing and making those plays that we weren't making early on. Just at the end of the day, and just making the plays when they come to you. And I think just total team effort just across the board. Our special teams is playing phenomenal. Defense is playing phenomenal, and the offense is just starting to get rolling.
How did it feel to finally be in the end zone again personally? I know it had been a long time.
I think that felt longer than coming off the knee surgery and getting the one against the Patriots. I think it's felt longer. A long season and a lot of, you know, ups and downs. But, yeah, it definitely felt good.
It seemed like you're open for like an hour on that play, too. I was watching it in the press box, like, he's open. He's open.
Yeah.
He's open.
No, I did. I think I waved my hand like six or seven times.
Right.
Thankfully Aaron's good at his job.
Extra pep in your step this week?
A little bit. Yeah, I do feel a little pep in the step. Definitely, that's for sure. Feeling good. I think everyone does. I think, like I was kind of talking about before, now that everyone knows what is at stake, I think people are more at ease rather than pressured. So
when you look at your performances this year, you've gotten some wins, you've had some close losses, but then right at the right time, you have your best game of the year last week in all three phases. You put up more than 40 points. What's it feel to finally click like that at the most important time?
It feels like us again. You know, I mean, I don't want to talk about obviously the past, but obviously, like, offensively, we've had success in the past with this, you know, core group. But just kind of felt like we're like kind of rolling again, and just feels pretty good. Right, like you said, right at the right time to kind of put up that kind of game on all three phases of the ball. Just kind of was a statement for. It's kind of like us to ourselves. Like, we're not looking for any external validation by any means. I think it was just, you know, reminding everyone in this locker room what we're about.
Robert, how have you seen Josiah kind of grow into his, you know, role with this team, and kind of especially some of the H-back stuff he's been doing this year?
First I'll talk about special teams, because a lot of guys, you know, across the league, like, don't, like, they take kind of special teams as like a negative, but he's embraced that role and playing as much as he can, as well as Tyler. But with the H-back stuff, he's getting a lot more reps in the game and including him more in the offense. And he's just so like dynamic in all of, you know, phases, you know, whether it's blocking on the perimeter, you know, running for the catch or routes or just all the fullback stuff. I mean, that's not a lot of people want to do that. Not a lot of people want to go between the gaps in the line and stick their face in there. And I give him a lot of credit for that. And, yeah, he's like a little brother to me. He'll probably not like the little part. But, he's amazing. I love that dude. And, he's projecting in the right direction, that's for sure.
He's really one of the unsung heroes, isn't he? I mean, it's like there's not many runs that you guys have that he's not a part of.
Yeah, and then, what is there, like six fullbacks, true fullbacks in the NFL? So, he does the dirty work on offense that no one wants to do, and then on special teams, he's one of our, you know, better special teams guys. So, a hero for sure.
Bobby, when this team was 4-8, did you imagine what could be here?
Yes. Men in this locker room. I do not have any doubt with any person in this locker room by any means. Just some things weren't falling our way. And there's things that we did that obviously didn't help. But sooner or later it was going to come around, and it did at the right time.
Do you feel like these young players on this team are understanding what it takes to win in this league?
Yeah. And I don't think that they, you know, right, didn't understand it at the beginning. But, you know, it takes, you know, to camaraderie, and it takes, you know, playing together. I mean, it takes the reps. And unfortunately that, you know, was the middle of the season where a lot of the young guys came into play. And then now, you know, we're hitting on all cylinders. So, I mean, looking to continue that throughout the rest of the way.
Do you believe in momentum?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Oh, yeah. I mean, get hot at the right time. Endless possibilities.
If you make the playoffs, it would be as the seventh.
When
you make the playoffs? It will be on the road.
Yeah.
Aaron's future's uncertain. He doesn't know how long he wants to play. Any thought that maybe this is his last game at Lambeau, and what does that mean to you to possibly take the field?
Didn't we feel like that was the last game at Lambeau, like the last 3 years?
I don't know, did you?
Never know. Just living in the now and just enjoying, you know, playing with a special player like that and what he's done for my career and how he's helped, you know, shape me for the rest of my career moving forward. That's and just kind of continuing that process and worrying about this season. I think I'm just kind of grateful and blessed to play with someone like that, not really looking at the, because, I mean, it is, you know, as he talks about it, it's obviously near the end because he's 52 years old. So, but, yeah, I mean, I'm just blessed to, you know, be on the same fields and in the same huddle, and, you know, he's helped me out a lot. So I'm just kind of just grateful and blessed. I can't say it enough.
You came back on a one-year deal, too. Have you put in with all this to, like, this could be your last game win?
Never know. That's why I'm just staying present and just trying to win a Super Bowl, and if whatever happens. But, yeah, I mean, let's just stay present on, you know, this season and all that. And, you know, there's so many people in this locker room with the same situation as me and as well as everyone. So I think that if that is the case, I think we're in a great mindset to take this last ride together. But, you know, where the chips may fall is kind of left up, not up to us, so.
Hey everybody, it's three guys with three things, and Mike, you are up.
Well, Larry, what we knew was going to be a challenging week for the Green Bay Packers became an even more difficult week with the events Monday night in Cincinnati. And the players all had their usual Tuesday off, but they came back to work on Wednesday, started with a team meeting on Wednesday morning, and it was described as a very quiet meeting. Everything that had happened with DeMar Hamlin was discussed. Players got a chance to talk about it. There's a process here to the players processing what they saw and knowing that, yes, all of their thoughts and prayers are with DeMar Hamlin and his family and friends and teammates in Buffalo. But there's also a game to prepare for, a very important one. This is the game they play, and this is what they're here to do. It's going to take the week, but the Packers are working their way through this.
Thank you, Mike. Wes?
Yeah, Larry, because the Green Bay Packers have a very difficult opponent coming up in the Detroit Lions. I mean, you look at the Packers and the kind of the run they've gotten on here the last month. Well, Detroit's been right with them here the second half of the season. 1-6 start. They've won 7 of their last 9 now. A very well-rounded team. Some familiar faces they're going to be seeing on Sunday. As difficult as all this whole thing's been, you have to be ready for a Lions team that's going to be very hungry on Sunday night.
Guys, the mixing and matching in the offensive line that's been going on pretty much all season continued the other night against the Vikings. Yash Nyman goes down, and goes Zach Tom. Been going on all year, and yet Pro Football Focus ranks everybody's offensive line 1 through 32 every week. And the Green Bay Packers for the season this week, they're ranked number 3. Number 3 with all that mixing and matching, and that's with all those measurables and analytics. Number 3. So hats off to that entire room, Luke Butkus and Ryan Mahaffey. A job well done. And that's three guys with three things. See you next time.
The snow didn't seem to bother the Packers' offense on December 6, 1992, as they routed the Detroit Lions. The Packers scored 35 points in the first half alone. Brett Favre threw for 3 touchdowns in the game, 2 of them to wide receiver Sterling Sharp. The defense contributed as well, as linebacker Tony Bennett returned a fumble recovery 18 yards for the score. The Packers won 38-10. Memorable moments brought to you by Oneida Casino. D love the taste. Worldwide, they gon' get a taste.